During the First World War, the British Army knew there were some tasks which were just too dangerous to be undertaken during daylight, and so they became very fond of what were broadly defined as night operations. There were three types of night operation: night marches, advances and assaults, and a fourth category was later added of trench raids and night patrols. Let's have a look at how night operations were conducted in 1914.
Night marches were used to move troops without the enemy observing them. This was especially important in this age of new technology, as aerial reconnaissance and artillery often inhibited any large-scale tactical movements. They could also be used to avoid the heat of the day in areas such as Mesopotamia and Palestine. Usually, large columns were used to move as many men as possible, as quickly as possible. Advances to battle were conducted in much the same way as in daylight, except that extended order was not used. In fact, soldiers were kept as close together as possible to ensure that none fell behind or got lost. Usually, it was recommended that a force moved in three lines, with over 100 yards distance between each line. This meant that if the first line was fired upon, the other lines could take cover and wait to reinforce when necessary. It was accepted that the first line of the advance was likely to sustain heavy casualties, and so the other lines were used to keep as many men as possible out of danger. The assault by night was perhaps the trickiest aspect of night operations. The attack was always carried out with the bayonet only, as firing in the dark was equally as likely to wound friend as foe, although soldiers did receive some training in night firing. It was usually to be made just before dawn, and if successful, could take the enemy entirely by surprise. Like in daylight, the assault was conducted by the junior commanders, and as it was impossible to coordinate an attack with other units when they were effectively invisible, it was up to them to decide when to charge. To understand how night operations were actually carried out by individual officers and men, it's best to look at a typical advance. Preparation and training for this type of operation was extremely extensive. Soldiers were taught how to see and hear more efficiently in the dark, how to move more quietly, and how to communicate with minimal noise. Before any night operation, soldiers had to muffle any kit likely to make a sound. They charged their magazines, but kept the magazine cutoff closed and the chamber empty to prevent anyone from accidentally discharging their rifle. The bayonet was kept fixed at all times. Smoking was not permitted, nor were other ranks allowed to show any light at all. Orders to this effect were to be reiterated by company officers at least twice before the operation. The job of the junior officers during night operations was perhaps the most demanding. All officers were required to be able to navigate at night, and it was their job to ensure that their men reached the objective quickly and efficiently. Typically, an officer would use both a compass prepared with luminous paint and the stars to navigate. The way forward may also have been marked ahead of the advance. For example, before the night operation on the 2nd of December 1917 at Passchendaele Ridge, Second Lieutenant John Scrivener of the 15th Lancashire Fusiliers was tasked with laying tapes and painting signs with compass bearings in No Man's Land to allow commandos to navigate. Despite his preparations, he was killed while leading his company in the attack the following night. Officers and NCOs also had to constantly ensure that their units stayed together and did not get lost or delayed. Various ingenious solutions to this were devised, with stationary troops even running lengths of string from the scouts to the commanders in order to maintain communication. Even so, it was always likely that some troops would be separated from the main force in the darkness. Field service regulations state that in night operations the element of surprise was essential, and it's true that many soldiers were invariably surprised by the situations they found themselves in. With limited knowledge of their surroundings, it was inevitable that troops would run into the enemy's scouts and patrols. In this situation, the regulations were very clear about what was to be done. They must be rushed in silence with the bayonet, without hesitation. If the enemy opened fire on the advancing troops, there was only one course of action. To fire back would risk hitting their own comrades, is that every man was trained to immediately charge forward with the bayonet and press on at all costs. It may seem a primitive tactic, but without their sight, there was no hope of a more organised assault. Night operations were perhaps the most complex and difficult aspect of the British Army's tactical preparations for war in 1914. Soldiers spent many sleepless nights effectively marching around, practicing the drills and techniques required, and officers were constantly examined in their ability to navigate and command without even being able to see their men. However, it paid off. Throughout the Great War, night operations were used in a huge variety of situations, from attacks and raids to large troop movements, and were undoubtedly effective.